AMD's upcoming RDNA3-based GPUs have been a topic on this channel before, and for good reason. The rumors are all but confirmed now. A AMD employee leaked the unique chiplet design on their LinkedIn page. And while it was just a confirmation of something we already expected, I want to take this opportunity to talk a little bit more in depth about RDNA3, why I think it will be a tipping point in the GPU market, possible pitfalls, and what Nvidia will do about it. When AMD introduced their first chiplet-based architecture with Zen 2, most of us, including me, didn't fully grasp how revolutionary a modular design really is. Now, more than 2.5 years later, modular CPUs are on every roadmap. With Zen 3, AMD already introduced their second-gen chiplet architecture. Intel calls their modular design Tiles, and rumors about an Apple M1 Quad are still very much alive. Basically, the CPU of the future is chiplet-based, there is no denying it. GPUs, on the other hand, have stuck to monolithic designs for so far. Both Nvidia's Ampere and AMD's RDNA 2 GPUs are traditional designs, and Intel's first-gen Arc GPUs will also be single-die based. But this is about to change with RDNA 3, and it has the potential to revolutionize GPU design, just like it did with CPUs. There's a reason why CPUs made the switch to chiplets first, because a modular GPU has to overcome one big obstacle in order to work properly: frame pacing. If you are old enough, you might remember the glory days of Nvidia's SLI and ATI's Crossfire. A high-end system with two 8800 GTX was the dream of every gamer in 2006, and the concept of dual GPUs evolved even further, spawning graphics cards with two GPU dies on a single PCB. Back in the day, just adding more GPUs seemed to be the way forward. Today, these concepts are mere remnants of the past, and the reason is latency. When Crossfire and SLI was at their peak, gamers started to notice a strange phenomenon. While running dual GPU setups, the frames per second reached new heights, but gameplay still didn't feel smooth. Today, in-depth performance reviews from the likes of Gamer Nexus, Hardware Unboxed, or Digital Foundry include more than just the minimum or maximum FPS. They also measure different layers of minimum FPS, different tiers, and frame time graphs. What you might consider a default for good benchmarks today was not the default back then. When we talk about frames per second, we usually think about a specific number, 60 FPS, 120 FPS, and so on. Values below 60 FPS often appear less fluid to our eyes, but as we know now, much higher FPS values still increase the fluidity we perceive. And high FPS also have another benefit, a reduction in latency. If more frames are rendered, there's less time in between them, at least that's the premise. In reality, the issue with high FPS from a dual GPU system comes down to the frame pacing, or frame time. 60 FPS should result in one new frame about every 60 milliseconds. But while systems with two GPUs would hit the 60 FPS mark, frames might be rendered in uneven intervals. So one frame would follow another one with only 8 milliseconds, but the next one would have a delay of 24 milliseconds. As a result, the gameplay didn't feel smooth. When doing something in real time, latency becomes important. And while modern PCs are working towards lower latency overall, it's still really hard to consistently control latency when you move your computing outside of a single die. Graphics cards are more affected by these issues than CPUs. As I mentioned, dual GPU setups are a thing of the past, while dual socket CPUs setups are very much alive. And that's the core issue for chiplet-based GPUs. AMD needs a solution to either have the same latency when communicating within a GPU and across to other GPU chiplets, or they need to make sure the output is uniform in latency. The question is, will RDNA 3 be two GPUs glued together, or will it act like one big GPU? From what we know so far, RDNA 3 will have three different variations. The small Navi 33 chip will probably still be a monolithic design, but Navi 32 and 31 will combine so-called graphic core dies with a multi-cache die. With up to 7,680 shaders per GCD, two of them will carry a whopping 15,360 shaders. Keep in mind, a single RX 6900 XT only has 5,120 shaders. We are talking about three times the shaders. Though, we don't know if RDNA 3 shaders have the same IPC as RDNA 2 shaders. Still, the performance leap a MCM-based GPU could deliver is astonishing. It's also interesting to see that the rumors still predict the same 256-bit interface with GDDR6 memory as the high-end RDNA 2 graphics card are using right now. The solution to provide more bandwidth is the MCD, which is rumored to carry as much as 512 megabytes of cache. And while talking about the rumored specs of upcoming GPUs is fun, with RDNA 3 the real question is, how is AMD approaching the MCM design? We just talked about SLI and Crossfire. Both of these approaches are using two completely independent GPUs, but they need to work together on a single task. Currently, there are two base concepts to approach such a design. The first one is alternate frame rendering, AFR in short, which directs the rendering of different frames on each GPU, one rendering all even and the other one rendering all odd frames. Each GPU is working on different frames independently, and when a GPU is finished with rendering, it delivers the result. With this approach, you always have to render at least one frame ahead, otherwise one GPU would idle. This is where we get the frame time issues from. Another way would be split frame rendering, or SFR in short, which divides the frame in a bottom and top half, each GPU rendering one part. In this approach, the frame time isn't an issue, but one part might still be rendered faster, resulting in waiting times. Imagine rendering a frame with a simple skybox in the top part and a demanding scene in the bottom part. GPU 1 would be done quickly, waiting for GPU 2 to finish the bottom part. There are other approaches, for example, splitting the frame into a checkerboard pattern, alleviating any uneven render loads, but all of these approaches are basically splitting up the rendering tasks onto two independent GPUs or more. I think the only real solution is to combine the GPU dies in such a way that they work together like one big GPU and the rendering work doesn't have to be subdivided on a software level. From my point of view, there are two obvious approaches for AMD to make a chiplet-based GPU work. Number one would be an optimized Infinity Fabric solution, much like a Ryzen connects two CPU chiplets and an I/O die through the Infinity Fabric. The question is if bandwidth and latency on the Infinity Fabric are up to the task. A high-speed and low-latency interconnect not only poses a technical challenge, it's also very power-hungry. In this approach, the GCDs and the MCD are on a single 2D interposer and are connected via the Infinity Fabric. AMD might use a more advanced iteration of the Infinity Fabric optimized towards latency to support GPUs-to-GPU communication. A second idea would be to use the multi-cache die as a kind of bridge that connects the two graphics core dies, maybe even including 3D V-cache technology like Zen3D. The GCDs would need properties V connection points to be able to interconnect with a part of the stacked MCD, but it could, in theory, form a very high speed and low latency interconnect between the two GPUs. Think of it as a Zen3D where the stacked cache connects both CPU chiplets. And that's where a new patent from AMD is coming in, describing active bridge chiplets with integrated cache. Does that ring a bell? I think this patent is describing the multi-cache die. Unlike the I/O die on a Ryzen CPU, which sits on the same plane as the CPU chiplets and is connected via the Infinity Fabric, the bridge chiplets AMD is describing in their patent sits on top of the graphics core dies, literally building a bridge between the chiplets. This chip probably uses a similar technology to AMD's 3D V-cache. The patent goes further into detail, specifically showing that this chip is stacked on top of the GPU chiplets and that it acts as a kind of funnel. The memory controller doesn't interact with each individual GCD, but only with the MCD. That way, the array could work more similar to one really large GPU instead of being treated like a multi-GPU setup with individual GPUs working on different frames. This approach would be the ultimate solution to the latency issue, ensuring a high-speed, low-latency connection between the GPU chiplets while communicating as one GPU to the outside. This patent was filed in September of 2019 after AMD has successfully launched Zen 2, their first real chiplet-based product. And by that time, you can be sure AMD was deep into working on their 3D V-cache technology. They also worked on implementing it for use with GPUs. Enough time has passed so far from the patent application that it's not unlikely to see tech like this used in actual products like RDNA3. I think there's a really good chance that we will see an active bridge chiplet with integrated cache used on RDNA3 MCM GPUs later this year. And it's new technology like this which enables new performance tiers. Maybe you're asking yourself right now, why even go through all this trouble? If latency and frame pacing is such a big issue for multi-GPU designs, why not just stick with a monolithic approach? Nvidia's upcoming HPC chip, Hopper, is rumored to be a 900mm² monster of a chip in TSMC's N5 process. Clearly it can be done. What's the advantage of splitting up a GPU into chiplets? The answer is pretty simple. If you have found a solution to the latency problem and can combine different chiplets to work as one, a modular GPU design is superior in every way. It starts with the design process because a modular approach allows you to base all of your products on a single chip. all we need to do is take a look at AMD's CPU lineup. AMD is producing a single CPU chiplet, and the same die can be used in all of their CPU products, from desktop Ryzen to Epic server CPUs. Instead of designing a huge monolithic high-end chip, a medium-sized mid-range chip, and a small entry chip, all you need is one single design. It's smaller in size, so the yields are better. For the entry-level GPUs, you just use one, maybe even a bin version. Mid-range chip can get a full or maybe even two chips, and high-end GPUs can scale to two or more. Less tape out needed, smaller chips, better yields. You can use every last single chip in different products. It's cheaper to design, cheaper to produce, and you can create much more powerful GPUs because when connecting the modular chips, you can reach a total chip size you couldn't produce when going monolithic. With RDNA, AMD released a competitive architecture for the first time in years, forcing Nvidia to release their Turing-based supercards. With RDNA 2, AMD did not only close the performance gap, but also offered better efficiency. The only area where AMD is still lacking is ray tracing performance. And with RDNA 3, AMD might finally be able to take a clear performance lead again. Of course, all of this is still speculation, but RDNA 3 is looking amazing so far. So what could Nvidia's answer be? There are three different scenarios in my opinion. In scenario number one, Nvidia competes with a monolithic design. Most advantages from a modular design result in cheaper and more efficient production. With enough power draw and a refined architecture, Nvidia could still compete performance-wise. And with the high GPU price in today's market, they will still make a profit. Margins might be lower compared to a modular design, but that's not our concern. Scenario number two has Nvidia pull their trap card and also release a modular GPU. Rumors are just that, rumors. Our current information could be wrong, just like everyone believed that G80 wouldn't use unified shaders. And then it did. Maybe Lovelace will surprise everyone. In scenario number three, RDNA 3 outperforms Lovelace on all levels, offers better efficiency, and is cheaper to produce. This would be a nightmare for Nvidia, but they have the funds to survive such a mishap. No matter how it will turn out, RDNA 3 has the potential to be the most impactful GPU architecture in recent history. But at the same time, it also has to prove that a modular GPU design can overcome latency and frame pacing issues. If AMD is successful, the future belongs to chiplet-based GPUs, just like with CPUs. As I said before, I'm more excited to learn about AMD's chiplet implementation for RDNA 3 than the final performance. Will they actually use the active bridge chiplet as the MCD to bridge all GPU chiplets together and form one large GPU? And I'm also looking forward to Nvidia's answer. Will they be able to compete with a monolithic approach or maybe surprise everyone with a modular GPU? Once CPUs and GPUs are fully modular, future APUs could start to be based upon a selection of CPU and GPU chiplets, which would further decrease production design complexity. I'd love to know what you guys think about RDNA 3, now that the 5 and 6 nanometer chiplet designs seem to be confirmed. Do you expect AMD to outperform Nvidia in the next generation? Do you think the technology described in the patent will be used? And will there already be 3D stacked components used within RDNA 3? Leave a comment down below. As always, if you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe for more content, and see you in the next video.